Welcome again to Manchester, and you welcome my first guest, who is an international film star, and his name is Saxon Steve. Saxon. Saxon Steve. On your seat, come on. Here, Saxon. Here, come on the seat. Quick, on the seat. Come on, sit down. He's had a tiring day, bless it. Now then, who are you shouting for? Your mum? He's shouting for his mum. Welcome his mum, Dorothy. Come on, Dorothy. Now then, a tale of two young men from very different worlds, worlds that could be about to meet in a very vivid way, and here is the famous one first, and the rest later. I'm trying to get dressed rather quickly while that was on. Now, that was Sting to the show business impresarios. That kind of young gentleman, Sting, from the Police, represents cash in the bank. He's what they call, in between cigars, box office. That is, if you can find a proper vehicle for him, which brings me to my next guest. He's called Paul Breeze of Stoke. Now, Paul's track record reads like a chapter of how to fail in business without really trying. He failed all his O-levels. He played in a mediocre pop group. He bored himself rigid as an NCB clerk. He humped sacks of clay in the potteries. He wrote books and sent them to the publishers, who said that he had no talent and please not to bother them again. But then, don't you know, he wrote this book, that particular book, While My Guitar Gently Weeps, which the big boys hope to film with Sting. Ladies and gentlemen, will you welcome the author, Paul Breeze. You're better dressed than I am. We're just trying to get now, let's just get Sting and Police out of the way so we can talk about UFOs. Yeah. The film moguls have bought the option on the book.
Yeah.
And it's to be hoped that Sting will play the part, Sting out of Police will play the part.
It's to be hoped, yeah.
But nothing is ever certain in this world, is it?
No, especially in films. It's pretty unreliable. But I'm pretty happy as it seems to be taking off, you know. It looks like a film probably will be made.
Right. And are you happy about somebody taking your baby, your book, the thing you've laboured over, and taking it away out of your hands? Are you happy about that?
Well, I suppose the book, nearly all books that are written and made into films, the books and the films usually, you know, have discrepancies, and I suppose I'll break my heart if it does turn out be right. Not what I, you know, not religiously to the book.
Right. But
I'm not complaining, right. I mean, I'm just happy it's right. Taking off, you right. Know.
Now, you're an odd lad. I mean, you've taken a lot of persuading about appearing here tonight. This is your first television appearance, and you're shy by nature.
Well, some people will say I am, other people will say I aren't, you know.
But you didn't want particularly to appear.
Nervousness, that's what it was. I think I'm getting over it now, though.
Listen, if a dog runs at your throat, then the time to be nervous.
I was a bit worried about this chair, don't
you? Of course you were, yeah. There's a lot of violence in the book, in your book.
Yeah.
One guitarist gets two of his fingers snapped off by a gang of thugs. Have you ever been any kind of that kind of violence?
Not that much, no.
You've been in a pop group, though?
You could say. It was sort of a youth club, and there was a couple of us. One youth played the drums, I played the guitar, and the other youth, because he happened to own a microphone, he decided he'd sing, you know, but we all lost interest. Well, they lost interest. I had visions of stardom, but it all fell through. And
you had visions of stardom?
Well, you do, don't you? Everybody does.
You've just met somebody who hasn't, now.
Oh, that's a good one.
That dog I'm talking about.
Oh. You know.
Now, the book, there is quite rich observation in the book, as well as the story, which is a quite violent story.
It's fairly serious. I intend it serious.
It is a serious book. I'm not doubting its serious intention. It's also rich in observation. For instance, you talk about telephone calls. There's quite a lot of telephone calling at the beginning. And you would say, quite wisely, one always assumes that any telephone call has to be bad news.
Yeah.
Which I entirely agree with. All the time the telephone rings, I think that's bad. Now, is that something you gather from your own experience? Have you had bad telephone calls?
Not really. I suppose when you it's only recently like I've borne out that and realised that what I've written was true. I mean, it was imagination before, you know, because I didn't possess a telephone. I wasn't posh enough, you know. So.
But you are now?
Oh, yeah, I've got a phone now, yeah.
You've had a miserable early young life. I mean, you were lousy at school.
I hated school. It taught me nothing, you know. It was just going to school every day. It's just the same as going work. It's just just a job. You just do it and you're just forced to learn things and do things that you don't really like doing, you know.
Did you write stories for yourself at school?
Not really. I thought that writing was for people, you know, like professors or something. You had to be really special. Ordinary people didn't write books, you know.
Yeah, and you thought you were an ordinary person.
Well, I still think I am.
Well, maybe you are, maybe you're not.
Did you? Probably not now.
When you started sending these books off to the publishers or the manuscripts, and they were rejected, how depressed did you get? What did they say to you?
Well, I didn't know anything at all about publishing. I didn't know what you did, whether you sent off or what you wrote on. You know, the first one I ever wrote, I wrote it down in longhand, and it had to be typed. Well, Lynn, my wife, she typed it, and we didn't know it had to be on like double line spacing. That's all the technical typing terms, you know. And it was on single line spacing and crossings out and here. You know. But I thought it was really a fantastic story, you know, because the first one I'd written, and I sent it off, and I got a letter back saying, we don't think you've got the talent necessary, you know. And I thought, oh, shit. And then, that was the end of it for me then, I thought. And I thought,
did you write that word down on the bottom as well, did
I said a lot more things.
Please don't go any further than you've already gone. No, that's far enough. You met Lynn, your wife, at the top rank where?
Anley in Stoke. Yeah.
Well, she's sitting on the front row. Why don't we ask her to join us? You move over there and you greet Lynn. Come on, then, you sit here. Now, you've supported him, haven't you, while he's been writing?
Yes.
You went out to work, and when did he tell you? He told you on the honeymoon night that he was going to be a writer.
Yes, the day after we got married, he started writing.
It wasn't honeymoon, though, was it?
No.
Well, he was too busy that night, but then the day after, he actually told you that he was going to be a writer.
Yes.
And you had to go out to earn the money for him to sit at home and write.
Well, for the first couple of years, he was working as well as writing.
Yeah.
But then he went on the dole, and I carried on working.
And then things got bad financially. I had to get a job again, you know. Couldn't survive off Lynn's money. Then got a job until... I just got sick of that again, and I tried writing to become a compulsion. And then I said to Lynn, do you mind if I pack it in again? It's either that or I probably would end up, you know, I'd run off or something, cut my throat or something. But I decided I've got to pack it in again. Lynn said, okay, she'd rather have me happy at home than miserable all the time.
But was he happy at home writing?
Oh, yeah, a lot better than when he was working. It was terrible.
Did he allow you to read what he wrote at the end of every day?
Well, to start off with, when he first started writing, I used to type for them. He passed over a sheet when he'd finished, and I used to type it. But when he was on the dole, I couldn't keep up with him because I was typing all day at work and I didn't fancy coming home and typing. So he used to type himself, and since then he's never let me on.
Do you have a mother and father? I mean, does he have a mother and father-in-law?
Oh, yes.
Well, what did you tell them?
Just that he was on the dole and...
You didn't. You kept it a secret?
Yeah.
Why did you keep it a secret?
Well, A was... I thought, you know, either... A, they think I was a sort of arty-farty person, you know, and that just wouldn't wash. And the other thing was, they either think, who the hell does he think he is? You know, this ordinary youth trying to write, you know, he's got visions. So I thought, best, you know, keep it to myself. It's also, if I'd have said to certain people, I'm trying to write, they'd also immediately think, oh, he's going to be great, you know, he's going to be a star and everything. Then their hopes would be high, and I'd be frightened of letting them down as well.
Is it sissy in the Potteries to be a writer?
Not really. I think that's a bit of a misconception. I think most people, you know, this is sort of, like you probably got this impression now, that people think it's a, sort of effeminate activity or something, but it's not like that at all. I mean, I think people looking now think it really proud, like, as somebody's written, and it's an intelligent thing, you know. I don't think it's sort of sissy.
Yeah, but it's the extraordinary story which I'm trying to celebrate, the fact that at school you were allowed, you failed all your O-levels, and here you are with sitting on a big book. How did the news come through to you that the thing had been accepted?
Well, I got a telegram. Well, it had been rejected a few times by publishers, this book had, and then I sent off to an agent. It was just random in a book called The Writer's Note this year, because it's got lists of publishers and agents and everything. Yeah. And just quite by random choice, you know, I picked out this name, A.D. Peters, and I thought I'll try and write off to them. I wasn't expecting it to be accepted, but they said, they read it, like, and they wrote back to me and said, we like this book, think it's got chances, but don't build your hopes up. So then, at that time, I had to get a job again because finances were low, so I thought, oh, God, here we go all over again, you know. And then I'd started work at this particular place, and I'd been there about 4 weeks, and I got home one night. Lynn was at college, actually, doing shorthand, and then a knock on the door. I was just having my tea. I think it was a meat and tater pie or something. And there's a knock on the door, there's a postman, and he said, I've got a telegram for you. You know, he said, why my guitar accepted by Michael Joseph? I thought, fantastic, you know. All them years of struggle, it was just great, you know.
What did you how did you celebrate that night?
I went to my grandma's, we had to.
Oh, how wonderful. Went up to see my grandma.
I had to.
Oh, that is wonderful. The story gets better, won't it?
I think somebody ought to film your life. I mean, that is a really good story.
Yeah, now he's still writing.
Yeah.
Does he clean your house for you?
Oh, yes, he does all the cleaning. So, I mean, we've got a great arrangement. I go to work and he does all the housework.
Does he go down to the laundrette?
Yes.
You're going to have a bloody awful time tomorrow when you get down to that laundry.
I'm pretty famous now already.
You are, aren't you?
Well, much continued success to you. I'm very happy that you've both joined us. It's a smashing story. And I hope the kids doing their homework tonight thinking, I don't understand what I'm writing down, may take heart from your story. Thank you very much, both of
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Terrific. Very good. Now, I like that story a lot. Do you remember when we used to sit round the wireless?